When people think of Buffalo, New York, often the first images that comes to mind are the snowstorms. They think of walls of snow, people shoveling themselves out of another blizzard. Of course, the other image to come to one's mind would be the Buffalo Bills, the team that left the urban core of the city to make its home in the outer reaches of the suburbs. It's the team that showed their resiliency by playing in four consecutive Super Bowls despite four losses. They're also the team that pulled together after a national tragedy of one of their players. Yes, this is Buffalo. The east side of Buffalo showed its true grit after suffering an unspeakable horror in the midst of what should have been a beautiful spring day. This place is also the city that gave birth to Rick James, the Stone City Band, and the Mary Jane Girls, exposing cultural vibrancy of this beautiful city. Buffalo is less known for her theaters, award-winning actors, and the thriving cultural arts community. This is the community that gave birth to the Njozi Ensemble, as we have been building a dream. For me, this is where it all began. This is the Langston Hughes Institute, or the building that was Langston Hughes Institute. I started here back in 1979 with a group called Spectra. And this was my home for a lot of years. This building was another home for me and will always, always be special. After my years with Spectra, I did some modeling, a few commercials, and some modern jazz dancing. In wanting my voice to be heard, I wrote my first play, Black Man's Burden. It was a play in skit form that combined six of my poems about growing up on the east side of Buffalo. A better title could have been Black Man's Angst, because that's pretty much all I showed. I then went on to write The Voyage from Chains of Glory. It was produced at my church with an outstanding cast. I love this one because it was my first time working with Rosalind Ruff. My next play was Creative Differences. This was my first production actually in a theater. It was produced at Hall Walls in the Black Box Theater. I wanted to do a play about the struggles of artists at different stages in life. This one starred Melvin Huffnagel, who was just graduating from college. It was also when I first met and started working with Stacey Alexis Cameron that turned out to be a long partnership.
Scenes in theater, I'd never really wanted to take the stage. But a friend of mine was involved with this production that Intari was doing. So I have to say that when I first met Intari, I didn't think that we were going to be friends. and so it just happened. And here we are, four years later. Yeah.
I had written, directed, produced, and appeared in my first three plays. The only problem was that I didn't have any theater training. So I joined Ajima Theater Company, where Lorna C. Hill agreed to mentor me so that I could learn the craft of theater. I did several plays there and was also Lorna's assistant director for several of the productions. I was still performing poetry and attempting to write my own plays. I started to find my voice within those plays that I was doing and through my poetry. I started doing performance poetry because initially I thought it was cool. Then I noticed that I was able to witness audiences reacting to my thoughts and words in real time. I had learned from Lorna Hill that no one could tell my story like me. When she said that, I took it to her.
I can't be a myth, but I believe you want something more tangible. A man more solid than an animal. Do you want African proverbs? Or your bills paid. is relatively simple as police sirens and fire engine screams are undecipherable.
I decided to start a performance group made up of poets. The first person who joined was Stacey Alexis Cameron. I had known her from when we did Creative Differences together.
I'm outside of myself, emptying pieces of my soul, because I thought that you thought that I was something special. I trusted you to do the right thing, but you only did what I let you in. I let you in through a revolving door, thinking I had no right to ask you to stay.
The draw for me was, hey, I have this idea to like get a group of artists together, get some poets together, and we're gonna like cipher, we're gonna write together, and we're gonna, you know, do some shows, and we're gonna write together, and we're gonna develop pieces together. And that was what really spoke to me.
We were later joined by Kendra Durant, Najib Awakil, Olu Long, Jumani Pitts, and Rodney Appleby with the Rodney Appleby Trio. That made up the first group that went out and did our first performance. Later that summer, when we did our second and third performances in my parents' backyard on their carport, we were joined by Anthony Neal and Vanetta T. Rhodes. The following year, we were joined by James Cooper III, and Akayate Bailey joined not too long after that. They brought a new energy and a new mix into the group that we previously did not have. Based on jazz and poetry, some hip-hop lyrics, this collection of educators, actors, and visual artists came together and was much more powerful as a unit than we were separately. Losing Kendra Durant at such a young age in March of 2011 will always be a loss. We will forever miss her. Doing something like this just seems empty without her. She was our friend.
One of the greatest parts of that experience for me was we would be sitting in a room, everybody writing their own things. And then we would like share like, hey, I just wrote this. And it sparked everybody to do more creation. And so for me, that's what it was about. It was like, this is a creative process and I'm in. Like,
what? Black people in love, black people in love. It's a beautiful thing. A beautiful thing, such a beautiful thing. Black people in love, it's a beautiful thing. A beautiful thing.
Njozi magazine started out as an idea that I had about a literary arts magazine regarding the Black cultural art scene around the country. I first talked to Cynthia Brooks, who told me that Eric J. Rosser would be a great addition. It began with Eric, Cynthia, and myself as the executive editors. Jerome Williams came on as our graphic designer, while James Cooper III was the illustrator. The name Njozi came out of a meeting with us as we searched for what to call it. We landed on a Swahili word for dream or vision. I decided to brand the rest of the company with Njozi so that we would have an immediate name recognition wherever we went. So everything became Njozi Promotions, Njozi Productions, the Njozi Poets, the Njozi Poetry Slams, the Njozi Ensemble. The magazine became special because we were the creative force of the content as well as the financial backers of the magazine. Our money came from the community. Our advertisers came right from the community. We didn't have someone else over us telling us what we could put in or we had to take out. We were interviewing national artists such as Stephen McKinley Henderson, David Wayne Cameron, Ra Goddess, Professor Griff of Public Enemy, and so many more. We also had the opportunity to highlight our own events. It was important to the culture because we were in charge of our own voice. We didn't design the magazine or write the articles from the influence of the white dominant society. We wrote everything with the community in mind. We started out putting up events with a few open mics that actually lost money. Then in December of 2000, Njozi magazine sponsored our first poetry slam. Unexpectedly, we had a packed house. After a few slams, we produced a few events as we premiered the magazine. By the midpoint of 2001, we put up our first Tri-City poetry slam, which pitted Buffalo against teams of poets representing Rochester and New York. The magazine gave us an unintended profile. Our events grew as we worked with other organizations spanning across the greater Northeast region into the Midwest and Southern Ontario. The significance of this was the broadening of our poetry community. We were not confined to the east side of Buffalo. Artists from multiple cities were being influenced by each other. Friendships, collaborations, and camaraderies were being formed. People were getting poetry features in many cities and were being paid appearance fees in Buffalo, which was almost unheard of except during Black History Month. Sometimes it was overwhelming to think that this organization's first shows were in my backyard. In our meetings to organize it happened in the small apartments of Eric Rosser and myself. Where Poetic Voices was based in jazz, the Njozi Poets was influenced by hip hop. The group was formed from the Njozi Poetry Slams. We just had so many hot poets coming through. I was trying to figure out how can I utilize all of this talent. All of these members were to compete in slams. A proud moment for the Njozi Poets was the summer where Howard Smith became the Grand Slam champion of the Nickel City Poetry Slam in Buffalo, while Archie the Messenger Barlow was the Grand Slam champion of New Eurekan in New York City. What was incredible is that he's the Grand Slam champion of New Eurekan while living in Baltimore, Maryland. But that was an incredible feat for the group to have two Grand Slam champions in two different cities in the same state, and both qualifying for National Poetry Slam. The group pieces that we came up with is where our power was found.
That was an incredible experience. That poem came out of, I know I had kind of shared with them a piece that I had written called Woman Power, the I Got It. That's where that line came from, was a piece that I had previously written. When I shared that with them, it just kind of came naturally. We just said, okay, well, we're just each gonna write a verse and see what happens, and we're gonna use I Got It as kind of like the thing to tie it all together. Their writing, like, I don't know, I it's hard for me to put into words what that experience was.
One breath I blew a breeze so cold, all the hell froze, had Satan standing in a wind shivering. Who am I? Who am I?
It's this more to life, and still I wonder.
Some get it from home, some get it from the streets, believe it or not. actions featuring gately entrances, hiding anti-military ammunitions. Boom, I got the world on its knees to my submissions. Blow it down. Either way, something is getting blown because I have the biggest bomb. Blow it down.
Dropping bloody deposits of scar, wrist, and dilated pupils.
Release us! Let my people go! Let my people stop!
Red lights from Tech 9, infrared, dead lights, red light, red light, red light, green light! Snap heads like! She was wrecked by her bed like, wishing she could give brain without giving head like!
Release the verses that curses young inner city brothers to hearses. Release the chains that pains us, inhibiting games against modern day strains. Release the essence of echoes that bellows inside of me. I am releasing this. You all poetry.
The Njozi Ensemble grew out of the Njozi Poets. At a certain point, I've been doing slams, but I knew I wanted to get back to my theater roots. So I started actually training many of Njozi poets to also be actors so that I could cast them into the plays that I was doing. Then I also knew I wanted to add singing, the old Negro spirituals, to our shows and include African drumming and dance. I wanted to include the singing because I had this catalog of music by Emma J. Tinley Horner that had been given to me by Loretta Anderson. I wanted those songs to continue living through us. The ensemble was also used to promote our plays, which included Lady Day in Langston, Ancestral Links, Love, and Other Revolutionary Mumblings, along with Ain't She Brave. I have to point out that all the flyers for just about every event that we did was done by Jerome Williams, who also sang within the ensemble and was part of the organizing efforts of everything we did. James Cooper III started co-hosting and sometimes just solo hosting our shows. And Stacy Alexis Cameron, along with Akayate Bailey, probably performed or worked in every iteration that we had within the Njozi family. I could not have done any of the stuff that I was doing without them. I first met Erica when I was booked to perform at Hilbert College in Hamburg, New York. They asked her to perform some poems, and I saw her and I was impressed. We didn't see each other again for 2 years. I was producing the Buffalo Niagara International Poetry Slam, and she entered as a contestant. When I heard her poem, she dropped a real hard first round poem. The second round, she was a little bit shaky. And so I sent her a message and I said, well, you know, like, won't you join up and work with my group for the summer? Because the competition was in June. If you work with me for the summer, I guarantee you a top 5 finish in the Toronto International Poetry Slam. And hopefully you decide to join the group. So she joined the group, and that worked out well for, I guess, both of us.
She started selling it cheaply on billboards and in shopping malls. And then I knew what it meant. She wasn't selling herself. That girl was being pimped. Come on. Try telling her she's worth more than that.
On our first date, Erica said that she had a poem that she had been working on. So she read it to me. It was a poem that I think she called Middle Passage. I ended up writing another verse to this poem, and those three poems became Middle Passage.
And then Mommy Watson's arms, I will never die.
And then she drank.
As the night falling down our backs, as we lay so close,
I could almost feel the reel and rock and sway in every lovely breath she takes.
As a ship climbs the tide, it bows and bends and begins again.
I spent all night wrapped deep inside the sweet ecstasy of her tide.
Erica was already working on Ain't She Brave when we met. She was working on it with another writer, but eventually their partnership fell through. I started working on the play with her. Then I enlisted the help of Lorna C. Hill to help shape it up. And for the first production, Lorna directed it. It was a huge success. Our attendance was incredible. The play picked up and went to New York, went to Phoenix, and eventually came back to Buffalo again, where I directed it this time. One of the many things that made this play so special were the audience reactions. I mean, from Phoenix to New York to Buffalo, the reactions were so strong. Eric and I had really tapped in to some stories, especially by Black women. They laughed, they cried, and they fully embraced the story. The talkbacks were phenomenal because the reactions were so strong from these women.
Us homegirls!
Yes, we gotta save the homegirls!
Save the homegirls!
I want the SATs to reflect my story.
Yeah!
This is the wild life,
and we are the wild fans.
Not my path.
Oh yes, oh yes.
The worldly pleasure soon will pass.
Definition of themselves. And I,
like them, am trying to write a new narrative for myself.
A journey, a pilgrimage, and I am finally
going home. And she brave. What did you think about the play?
It was brilliant, man. It was incredible. The women were up there. They were working. I really dug
the best part.
The writers really, like, it made us sing.
I love the fact that I learned so much of the history of Black people. When I'm at a place where I feel like the Black history is not being taught in schools,
reflect on the people that have made us what we are today.
It's fantastic. I loved it. Completely. I wish I would have came to open tonight, and then I would have came a few more times after that.
The Njozi Ensemble ain't done yet. We still have plays to produce and shows to mount. So our future is looking very bright. So there's a little bit about the Njozi organization. In the future, we will be having a full-length documentary about the Njozi organization, the building of it, and interviewing several of the people who made it what it was. So until that time, I'm Ntari Ali Gault. Peace.